So my name is Magnus Rudolfsen and I come from Bokbasen, a Norwegian distributor of ebooks and audiobooks. Laura invited me to have a talk about audiobooks exploding. So I was considering what is the most explosive things about audiobooks today, and I guess it's the market development. With the APA, the Audiobooks Publishers Association in USA, stating that it's the fastest growing format in the industry. First, a little bit more about who we are. We are, as I said, are a Norwegian distributor. We distribute ebooks in the Nordic markets. Our main business areas are metadata, ingestion, cataloging, distribution to all retailers and libraries in Nordics. Not libraries in Sweden and Denmark, but all libraries in Norway. We distribute ebooks, audiobooks, and have systems for also for access to digital textbooks and other materials, as well as order and logistics systems for digital materials. So we support, our system supports both single copy sales, subscription models, and library models coming later this year. The Norwegian market is, of course, a small market due to the fact that we are only 5.5 million Norwegians. But I wouldn't say technologically advanced, but most Norwegians have access to the newest technology and are very keen to have that, acquire that. So, and also with the, not so much these days, but with the oil, it's also a country that has a population with a lot of money. So they want to buy both books and technology. We are a fixed price book market in all formats. So the first year the book is published, and until May the next year, there is a fixed price. The retailers can only discount that with 12.5% maximum. So that's a bit different from Sweden, where there's a free price market. So with the audiobook part of the market, it's been around since 2007. First with digital downloads of MP3s on specific, not downloads, but on like preloaded MP3 players and such. So there were devices that were sold that would contain MP3 files, but they were not downloadable. Then digital downloads started to take off more in 2013, which I will get back to. The market is roughly divided between two large publishers, one of them being a publisher that acquires rights from other publishers to produce the audiobooks. And the other one and this publisher is called Lydbokforlaget, which is audiobook publishers directly translated. And the other one is Cappelen Damm, which is half owned by Bonnier, which many of you might know. Today we have seven online retailers that sell downloadable ebooks, audiobooks, and three of them provide subscription models. They're called Fable, they're called Storytel, and ebook.no provide those models. So looking into the tech part of the market. So 90% of the population have a smartphone. So it's close to full market penetration, and the market is only where devices are mainly replaced. And the second thing is that 45% of audiobooks are consumed on smartphones, which is not surprising. It's perhaps more surprising that 26% is on CD players, or even that some have a dedicated MP3 player still. The market is we conduct a yearly market study, and we ask some questions. And the data you see in this presentation is partly from the survey, and partly from actual data from our distribution platform. So this is from our survey. How relevant is it for you or your household to have access to ebooks and or audiobooks? And you see that the interest in audiobooks and ebooks is roughly the same. And that's what you see also on the market side, that sales of audiobooks and sales of ebooks are almost at the same level in the Norwegian market. So from our distribution data, we see that those that have downloaded an audiobook, 50% of them also have downloaded an ebook. So there's a part of the market that are listening to audiobooks exclusively, and there's a large part, and half of them are also ebook users. So we've seen this number also are growing now when we're starting to have dedicated retailers doing only digital formats like ebook.no. They only sell ebooks and audiobook downloadable audiobooks. The growth in audiobooks, downloadable audiobooks, from 2015 to 2016 was 24.5% in the Norwegian market. The audiobook CD sales were down 11% in the same period. So that adds up to a 6% net growth in all formats of audiobooks. So at the same time, Storytel is reporting very good development in subscription numbers. The latest number is 381,000 subscribers worldwide. With the latest number I can remember right now from Storytel Norway is that they have about 30,000 paying customers. And we had the two new subscription services going live this year as well, connected to our distribution platform. Customers seem to be moving from CDs to digital, physical to digital, and customers seem to be moving from single copy sales to subscription models, which is not so clear in the numbers, but as we are still experiencing growth on single copy sales as well as growth in subscription numbers. So let's look into how explosive this is really, and let's look at the numbers from the last years. So this is the sales development year over year in revenue. So the revenue here is it's in 1,000 NOK, so it's 40. The top number there is roughly 4.5 million euros. So that's the scale. So from 2011 to 2016, you see we have quite a good growth, with the best being from 2014 to 2015. It's a bit slowing from 2015 to 2016. So it's a 65% growth from 2014 to 2015 and 24.5% then. So, and this, if you add the CD sales to this, see, it's almost purely changing formats. So CDs, physical going down, digital going up, and then you know, like right now there's 50-50. And then if you see the total revenue, it was going down until 2013 when digital downloads got traction, and that pulled up, so we got a good development from 2013 and until now. So digital downloads are definitely recruiting new audiobook listeners, and also because of the good growth in downloadable audiobooks, the offerings are expanding. So In the Norwegian language, we have now 4,500, roughly, titles in sale, which is not an impressive number, of course, in the world scale. But this is new relevant titles in Norwegian, and there is about between 650 and 750 titles added each year, and I've seen some. I got some numbers from Virginie also that gathered some international numbers, and the numbers for Germany were not that high in number of titles added each year. I think it was 800. So for a small market like Norway, we have a big focus on audiobooks and audiobook production. In ebooks, we have roughly 10,000 titles, which is all new published after 2011 titles, and every new book is also published as an ebook. And just as a reference, for the growth in ebooks are about has been for the last year about 35% in Norway. So the market is growing healthily. I was talking about fixed price. It's a fixed price market, and this is the average price in New York, in Norwegian kroner, 184 kroner, the top number there. It's 20.3 euros. I would imagine that's quite expensive in an international scale. So you see that in May, that's the time of year when the fixed price titles are released for free pricing. So the average price tend to drop from May to the summer. And then it picks up again in the fall when new books are published. So, and this also corresponds quite well with a spike in sales, which is also a part price, part because of the season. It's we see most interest for ebooks and audiobooks in holiday times. So Easter is a big. Big season, summer is big season, and the growth every year then it goes up, and it's more like we get the step in the summer. So earlier there was a lot about statistics on ebooks saying that every Christmas there was a holiday where many people would buy ebooks, and you get that go up a step. We see that in the summer mostly. In formats. So our audiobook platform delivers MP3 files in segments as complete files in 2-bit rates right now, in 48 and 128. We will be moving to offering 64 as our standard format instead of 48 and 128, because we see that that compromise between size and quality, I think we find that 64 is a good place to be. 48 being, in some regards, a bit too low on quality, and 128 creating too big files. And we also provide this in HLS for streaming, and also for gradual downloads on Android and such. So the booksellers that integrate with us also typically have their own apps. They develop their own apps and have their own audiobook players. But the problem is that there is no good structure. You have the ID3 tags, but you don't have a real good structure of metadata to indicate when a chapter starts or ends, or how to navigate through the book and everything. So this is a screenshot. I'm not sure if you can see it, but this is a best-selling fiction, which is a very big book. It's very long. It's like 40 hours long, and it's in segments, and you can see it's up to 200 something, or maybe even 2,000, but you can't see it because there are so many segments because the book is so long. So it does allow you to navigate each segment, which is quite good because there are only like 7-10 minutes in each segment, but you can't navigate to the correct segment because there are so many segments. And if you have it in one file, you can never hit the correct place in the audiobook using a slider like that in a 40-hour book. The resolution it's impossible to navigate. So what we are looking into now, and also what we would like would like to see with EDR Lab and Iridium 2 as well has some audiobook support, is that we can develop some standard of structure for navigating an audiobook and to indicate when a chapter starts and ends, and that is specific to audiobooks, and that would work with Iridium. We have looked on EPUB 3 audio only and looked at the possibilities there, but I also think that the possibilities with doing it with more lightweight, like when we were thinking with the portable web publication with the JSON structure that indicates the structure of the book. And I think that's really a work that needs to be done, because audiobooks are books, and it should have a book structure, not try to use ID3 tags meant for music. Yes. So we are. I have had some discussions within Iridium, and would like to see more work in that area going forward, because it's a real need for to create user-friendly experiences with audiobooks, as it gains more and more traction. So the takeaways would be that audio is an increasingly important format with great growth in digital. We're still seeing decrease in the physical, but the increase in digital makes up for it. And so customers are moving from old formats to new formats. Which I'm saying to twice here, I see, but yeah. And they are also tending to move from single copy sales to subscription models. And what we see is that audiobooks are more popular in subscription models, where you have both audiobooks and ebooks at the same time, like you have in Storytel. The audiobooks are more used. It's their selling point. They have their headphones. It's the whole point of their marketing, is that they're audiobooks. They also have ebooks, but it's the audiobooks that sells the product. So there's a real market for subscription models in audio. But to be able to provide a good product, and so that more people, more booksellers can create user-friendly systems, there's a need for standards. So that's what we would like to see more of. So I also have some statistics here from the international markets, I will not go through that in detail, because the statistics are so unreliable, so I feel that I can only rely on my own data. You can download the whole presentation after and see the numbers yourself and read through it. But the key takeaways from the international markets as well, France, Germany, UK, and US, is that all of these markets are experiencing great growth in audiobooks, with the Audiobooks Publishers Association of the USA saying it's the fastest growing format in publishing. So I think this is it's exciting to see the development of audiobooks, but it's going to be exciting to see if subscription models will totally take over the single copy sales in this area, because I think this area is much more prone to that than ebooks have been. So it's going to be interesting to see. Thank you.
We have some questions for, yes, two questions. So let's begin with Bill.
Okay. Magnus, do you have any sense of uptake in streaming versus downloads and how that's developing in your market? I mean, there's this question of, you've got these huge files, why bother with files at all?
Yeah.
Right? And so I'm just wondering what the feeling is among distributors and your user community about going to streaming versus downloads.
Yeah, so technically for streaming, I have the live data here. So I'll...
Okay.
Yeah. Download stats. So we... Yeah, so it's... the statistics is not quite conclusive, because some of them use streaming. They download chunks that they use the download, like, as a streaming. But I think that even in the Norwegian market, let me see if I can actually find it. Maybe Kjetil, you have the data?
To separate downloads and what is used as partial downloads specifically streaming.
Yeah, but it seems like we have about 7,000 download requests today, until this time of day, and we had 3,000 audio stream HLS requests today. So yeah, 30% streaming.
Is that increasing over time, or how is that changing over time?
It's been pretty stable since we started. Nothing really that much.
But on Android, it's hard to separate them. We don't know for sure how much of the file was streamed or downloaded, partially downloaded. Yeah.
Avnish, you have a question?
So first question is, confusion is there. Radium provides very good navigation for the audiobooks right now. So what addition are you looking for there? And we have extensively developed the DAISY audio link guidelines for EPUB 3. So if you have gone through it, what are the issues that you are facing in using that?
I think the main issue with the DAISY form, or not with the format, but with the use of it, is that the publishers are not producing it. They're not providing that metadata when they produce the books. Those are only done by specialized studios mostly. So what?
The guidelines that I'm talking about, these are for EPUB 3. So it is the guidelines for EPUB 3 publications to provide the navigation experience like DAISY.
Yes.
So the file set is EPUB, everything is EPUB. The navigation is chapter-wise, page-wise.
Yeah.
So everything is EPUB there. There is nothing in the file format. There's nothing DAISY. It's the behavior is like DAISY books.
Yes. Yeah, technically, of course, it's EPUB, it's not DAISY. But the struggle is the same, that the publishers, when they are producing, they are not providing the metadata that indicate where a chapter starts and ends. So there's never any... You have to produce, you have to think about that from the start. And for the main part of the audiobook market, they're not thinking about accessibility first. They're thinking about creating a user experience for their main customer. We have tried to do several things in the accessibility part. Like, we have an agreement, for example, with the Norwegian Library of Talking Books, where we transfer automatically every EPUB that we distribute. So every Norwegian EPUB that's ever published are automatically transferred to the Library of Talking Books, so that they can use the EPUB for their production. But it's always trying to fix something that the publisher has not done. So I think that it needs to be more clear and easier, so that we can have part of the structure, maybe from the publishers, and that still it's easier to add what's needed for doing full accessibility later.
And
audiobooks are audio only. They're not audio plus text.
No, this is audio only.
Yeah. Yeah, and just a clarification, the DAISY only guide, sorry, the audio only guidelines for EPUB produced by DAISY, these are also audio only. Bill, this audio only, it simulates the media overlays behavior without text. So technically, it is media overlays under the hood, but behavior is like audio.
Yeah, they could do it, they're just not doing it.
Yeah.
I think that issue really goes back to the chicken and egg that we all get ourselves into, because at least at PRH, the reason we don't use EPUB as a wrapper is that nobody's asking us for it. The minute that we have a retailer who says this is what we want and need, then we would do it. But me just saying this is what we should do when we have nowhere to send it doesn't make it happen. Yeah. So it's not just the publishers, it's the whole ecosystem.
So that's what we're trying to influence by working with establishing standards on how we do things in our market, so that we can say to our retailers that now we have a new format, we've added this to the list of formats you have. You can choose between the single file, the chunked file, or you can choose a EPUB 3 audio only, perhaps soon to do that. So we would like to do that, but we're not there yet. But the players would need to be updated, and we are, as a distributor, we are trying to influence the retailers to go in that direction.
And this is where Region 2 can be of use, because the user interface part can be not only a web browser, but it can be something else. It can be a player, an audio player. So we could mix and match what is the, for example, the pure audio EPUB 3 profile plus the future audio PWP that we'll try to push on with the W3C. We can implement that inside the prototype first, then a real product based on Region 2, just by adapting the format to the user interface and replacing the browser, which is made for text, with a pure audio player that is good for audio.
What about security? How do you secure your files?
Right now we watermark them with an unhearable frequency. So it's a frequency that humans can't hear, that can be reverse engineered to the order ID. So every audiobook that we deliver is unique per customer right now. So yeah, and we're looking into adding a hearable, like at the start of a book as well, indicating that this file contains this kind of information. So that, because I think that and as well as ebooks, we don't have any DRM on ebooks. We only have a watermark, so to say, on the ebook file as well, indicating the rights, like the copyrights, and then the order ID of the transaction. So it can be traced back to the buyer if it's still intact. And so that's the only type of DRM that we have in the Norwegian market.
Thank you. I think it makes sense to use a DRM that does not influence the reader or listener at all, which watermarking actually does.
Yeah, so we don't have the issue with that. We have a lot of Norwegians buying English books from Amazon, of course. Everybody does that. But all of the Norwegian ebooks and audiobooks are compatible with every other system, so they're not locked into our system. And in addition to that, we have what we call the Book Cloud, which is all of our retailers are connected to the same infrastructure in the back end. So if they use the same email address across multiple retailers, it's all synced to one central server, and that feed is available in the OPDS format. So all of the reading and audio listening apps can sync to this and get all of their books. So they can do their, the customer can go around, they can buy from there and there and there, and it all syncs, and they can choose whatever audio or ebook software they want.
Okay, thank you very much.